because companies just realize, hey, we can do this. We don't have to have office space for them to have, you know, flex time or other benefits, and employees don't have to have the travel time. Of course, it's also green, and I see this like return on investment. I put time into making something, and the more people who can see it and benefit from it, the better I feel.
Hello and welcome to Break Free with Top Rank Marketing. I'm Joshua Knight, Senior Content Marketing Manager at Top Rank Marketing. And I'm here this time with Eric Vanderberg. He is the VP of Cybersecurity at TCDI. He's an author and a speaker, and in general, a very smart person that we need to hear from, especially right now. Eric, thanks so much for joining us today.
My pleasure. Glad to be here.
So I would imagine, as a cybersecurity expert, the fact that our entire lives have moved into the online realm in the past 6 or 7 months has led to some exciting and interesting times for you. Is that true?
It sure has. I've been involved in a lot of incident response and investigations and helping companies figure out what's their strategy moving forward, as this has disrupted so much of their workflow and created some new hassles for them.
Have you seen any people that were truly prepared for something like this to happen, or has it generally been folks a bit of a scramble?
I wouldn't say anybody's been fully prepared. There's been a little bit each company's had to do. You know, some companies have been a little bit better prepared on like the technology side. They had what they needed to enable employees to work from home, and they had the security in place, and they had good procedures and training, but then, you know, they miss out on some other element. Maybe there's a communication breakdown, and now business email compromise was their downfall, or you know, they got all the others and they didn't do the training, or they had issues implementing the technology, and then there were vulnerabilities or other issues that allowed attackers in. So, you know, there's a lot of different things you have to do in order to be secure. And with this pandemic, it's caused many companies to have to react. Unfortunately, when you're, you know, reacting without necessarily having a plan in place, you introduce faults and errors.
And we talked a lot about, when we talk about the pandemic, about how people's 5-year plan suddenly became a 5-week plan or a 5-day plan. I can imagine there are just a ton of moving pieces that people had to consider as they move forward.
Yeah, there really were. This, you know, a complete change in the way we do business, and not one that companies necessarily planned for. You know, some were certainly moving along on distributing their workforce and utilizing, let's say, more contract work or using this as part of their digital transformation. But others said we're just, you know, blindsided by the whole thing.
Do you feel like even separate from the pandemic that we're seeing some true and lasting progress in people's approach to cybersecurity and the way that they're implementing it?
I think so. It certainly highlighted, one, this need for communication and the need for awareness. We've seen far too many issues, and you know, the employees are being exploited first. So, in you know, empowering them and giving them what they need in order to do the work, but to do it securely, I think we've come a long way, and this is encouraging for me to see that. I've also seen us moving more into the cloud. You know, some companies have said, "All right, well, look, I needed to get people into all these resources and trying to have them connect into some internally hosted things and working." So they're moving on up to the cloud. And then this generally has a benefit, not only for cost and for, of course, aligning your expenses with your use case scenarios, but also in security, since those companies are really applying a lot more technology and processes to secure your data out there than you probably were if you were a small, medium-sized company.
Do you think there are things that the frontline employees, like for me, I'm a marketer, I'm not in the leadership at my company, but I am working from home. Like, are there things that I should be doing at home to make sure that I'm supporting cybersecurity for my organization?
Sure, there are actually quite a few. So you may be using some of your personal equipment to do business. So you want to make sure that that equipment is up to date, that you don't have a junk software on there, I'll say, that you're running up to date virus software, and that if you're connecting into company resources, you don't also have a connection to, you know, other things. Let's say games running at the same time while you're connecting to the company resources can, you know, allow attackers to jump from one system to another system. And there's, of course, the awareness, you know, you pay attention to what's going on in the industry. This could be, you know, just watching the Twitter feeds of some cybersecurity people, but, you know, pay attention to what's going on so you can be on guard against some of the attacks.
So it seems like we know that security has always been everyone's problem from low to high, and obviously this is becoming more top of mind for everybody. Do you see this being a long-term change as far as the approach and the processes and some of these changes, or do you think that we're going to kind of regress to the mean over time?
Well, from some of the studies I've read, it looks like, you know, there's going to be a significant change. We talk about like working remotely. It was, you know, just a few percentage of working remotely before the pandemic, and now it's almost everybody. But then afterwards, well, we think that it's going to settle around somewhere, you know, 20-30%. Because companies just realize, hey, we can do this. We don't have to have office space for them. You have, you know, flex time or other benefits, and employees don't have to have the travel time. Of course, it's also green. So say, hey, we're, you know, using less fuel, less carbon emissions, going back and forth. So there's, you know, a lot of reasons why, and we're going to definitely see an uptick of that. Then these some companies have waited to implement certain technologies. Maybe that's their remote access technologies. Maybe that's moving to the cloud. But now that they've made that investment, they're going to capitalize on that. So they'll continue to utilize these new processes, procedures, technologies, all those things that they've put in place. That's the new normal.
The new normal sounds really good. I especially like the normal part, because it seems like we've had a shortage of that in the past several months. But it's true, I don't miss my commute as much as I thought I would. I'm getting behind on podcasts. That's about the only problem that I'm seeing. But are you seeing that as some of these things are rolling out, that there are things that people are overlooking or getting wrong or making mistakes about that you would want to correct?
Yeah, there's quite a few. So, you know, when a lot of employees suddenly start working from home, many are using personal equipment. Maybe they didn't have a company device or have a way of properly managing those. And so we've had a huge influx of the, you know, the BYOD, bring your own device. And some companies weren't ready for that. They didn't have a process in place to manage that. Others were able to take kind of the right approach, either securing those devices with endpoint agents or just taking the kind of personal device, not really out of the mix, but connecting them into virtual desktops and keeping your data up there and either the cloud or local resources. And that's helped to secure it and also give them the same feel and applications and everything else that they had when they were in the workplace.
So I think you addressed pretty well some of the steps that people can take to solve some of these security issues. I think we should just move on to... So let's talk about, say, a year from now, when there is a vaccine, fingers crossed, and things are starting to open up again. What do you think that the cybersecurity landscape is going to look like as that starts to happen?
So I think that we're going to certainly have quite a few new cloud players. I think we're also going to have companies who are much more agile, are used to using some of those resources, utilizing, could be in addition to the regular workforce, you know, a lot of other outside either consultants or, you know, flex resources. We're going to see fewer people in the office. We're just getting used to that. And maybe, you know, some offices closing down and opening up other, you know, regional places because it's easier to, you know, work remotely and to coordinate. Certainly a lot more use of technologies to help coordinate, you know, project management type tools and communication platforms and all that. Those have already seen a big surge, and I think we're going to see a lot more there.
So what steps do you think that B2B leaders, so anybody who's on an executive team, should be taking right now as we're kind of exiting this panic mode and into this planning mode for the future?
So they should be looking at, you know, what were the changes we needed to make in order to survive the pandemic? For now, most of us, you know, survivors of this situation, because we start to come out of it. And, you know, you look at those technologies, those processes you put in place, and now say, oh, well, how can we use this to, you know, generate more business value, to become leaner and more efficient, and to provide better quality and service to customers? And that's going to be the key, as they look at that and they and they see that there are definite advantages, and they're going to move down a new strategy to utilize the resources.
So just getting out of that triage mindset and getting more into the planning mode. It's okay, we'd put all this stuff in here. Now let's see what we actually need and what we can get out of what we have.
I said, I think they'll see a lot of synergies, a lot of new opportunities for them.
New opportunity sounds good. We always talk about, like, it's rough to think about getting something positive out of a disruption like this, but there is opportunity anytime you have the upending of the status quo and the way we've seen it. Is that how you've been seeing people reacting now? Let's look at the opportunities we have.
Some are still in that crisis mindset, but I've started to see a smaller percentage of them start looking to the future and say, what can we be doing moving forward? Mm. And sometimes they're the ones who are talking to me and saying, how can we made all these changes? You helped us be secure. And now how can we leverage this? In some cases, it was like, hey, we always wanted to kind of get to a point like this, and now we are. So are we going to market this to our customers, or are we going to get some of that business we always talked about doing, but now can't? Maybe they were staying away from being the HIPAA business associate. Now they realize, hey, we put it all in place. And so now we can start working with those healthcare companies we had avoided.
But to definitely not say, thank goodness this is over and we can be done with this cybersecurity stuff.
No, I haven't heard anybody say that, but they're saying it behind my back.
That makes a lot of sense. So I want to talk about a subject that usually makes people uncomfortable when we bring it up. But you are someone who is a thought leader in this space. I think that term's appropriate here. And marketers like me, when we're looking for how can we bring something of value to an audience who wants to learn about cybersecurity, we want to come talk to you. And I want to know how that came to be. Like, how did you become a thought leader in this space, and how did you build that audience?
Well, I've always been interested in certainly sharing ideas and trying to empower people with knowledge. I had spent some time in education, a couple years designing a program and teaching students about networking technology, security, servers, and all those things. And I have maintained a blog for a couple of decades. And that kind of morphed into the social media as that took off. It was a new way to interact with a large audience. There was certainly a lot more communication than just me, pushing out content and people reading it. Here I was able to interact. And I started developing that a lot more. It allowed me to broaden my network as well, because it's not just a one-way street. It's me learning from many other people and then other people learning from me. So I've been able to kind of expand that network, figure out who I can learn from, how to collaborate. And a lot of new businesses come from that, but also many opportunities to share what I've learned or share what other people have learned and bring that out to the audience. It's also was just an easy way for me to kind of pull through all the information that's out there and figure out what I wanted to read. And so, if it was important to me, I figure it was important to other people. The process of already filtering and sorting through new information, and might as well.
It seems like in the B2C space, people who are an Instagram influencer, they put a lot of thought into building an audience as as an end goal unto itself. But it seems like, and correct me if I'm wrong, that your approach was more, I want to learn things. I want to teach what I know to people. I want to interact with people who interest me. And the audience kind of followed from that. Is that true?
Yeah, that is true. I wasn't necessarily just trying to, grow some big following. Celebrity status was always something that scared me a little bit, because I'd see all of the downsides to it. Now, I'd have to watch my back or couldn't do normal things. So I certainly didn't want that, but I did want to be able to engage with people. And I've always wanted to, what I write or what I think, I know that has a benefit. And so kind of see this like return on investment. I put time into making something, and the more people who can see it and benefit from it, the better I feel. So that was a big part of it, just getting the information out. I know that the security is something I'm very passionate about. Knowledge is something I'm passionate about. And I know how much it can benefit companies, individuals who, then won't be susceptible to these attacks, or can use that technology in a better way to move us forward. And so it's not something that I really have to hoard. I want so many more people to benefit.
That seems to be right in line with the way that we approach this stuff. It's just, let's get the information out there and let's give people something valuable that they can have. But as somebody who is looked up to and who has built this audience, do you find that that feels ever limiting about what you can say? Like, you might say, I want to make this post in support of this cause, but that might turn off my audience. Like, is that ever a consideration for you?
Yeah, it is. Now, I've taken a different approach from some people. Some people said, hey, this is great. This is my platform and I'm going to use it for my voicing all of my personal opinions on other things. For me, it was always something for technology and security. And so I've chosen to not really mix it with everything else. You know, do I have political views? Yes. You know, do I have my own religious views? I do, but I have a different outlet for that. You know, I actually have several different, I have my different group for, Christian gamers and stuff. And I have those outlets. And so I kind of keep that content there rather than mixing it in there. I certainly know that, some readers aren't interested in that, and that's fine. So I just keep it specific to those two areas.
That makes a lot of sense. It seems like there are many ways to approach that. And there are some who are very personality driven and say, nope, this is me. You got to take the whole package. But there's definitely something to be said for dividing separating the professional from the personal. For those who can do it, I keep trying and it keeps bleeding over every now and again. You see something on Twitter that you just have to respond to. But maybe I should make a different account for ranting.
Sometimes you feel the need to go and comment on something and then I have to bring it in.
I could just use the correct spelling of my name instead of the wrong way that it's spelled, N-I-T-E. And maybe I could make a private one to rant politically. But thinking about, though, working with people on creating content, has there been something that you've worked on that you thought was a really groundbreaking or just cool, exciting thing to be part of? And if so, what made it that way?
Hard to think of just like a single one. I've really enjoyed almost all of the engagements I've had. When I first started with Townbreak, that was well over a decade ago. And I don't know if we're mentioning, who we've worked with and all that, but just working with a big customer, it was great meeting other influencers in the space and kind of learning how we all could better support one another and how they were getting their messages out. So I think that was really great. I've always seen this as bigger than any individual. So a lot of these collaborative works have been great. If it was not just a single podcast, maybe it was podcasts with several different people, or when we're working on a campaign and the other people who are working on it can be able to help support them or read what they're doing or collaborate. Those have been some really engaging and fun opportunities. But then anytime I'm doing something new, I always like that too.
I like hearing the idea that being able to talk to other thought leaders in the space is part of the idea. So I think if we're doing it right, that's what it is. If we have six people in an ebook, we don't want to just keep them in little compartments. We want to say like, hey, Eric, meet, Oliver Christie, and everybody, we can have a space where people can chat. It sounds like that's something that's valuable to you.
Yeah, it is. And I've certainly approach that. Sometimes I'll get contacted by the media for a quote for an article where they want to interview me for something. And then I ask a few questions, and sometimes there's another person I can connect them with who can also be in on that article or help them with something else. And so I play that, and then get to have the best resource for it, or people in my network benefit.
I think I kind of want to take this question both ways. If somebody is trying to get you involved in a project, what is something that makes you more likely to be involved, and what is something that is an automatic, oh no, thank you?
So certainly, well, if it's something, a topic of interest that's new or one that's where I can take a really unique angle, that's what I really love to find a unique angle on an existing topic, maybe take a lot of the information that's out there and kind of synergize it, but then come at it from a different approach. So like, I'll just talk about ransomware. So I wrote a number of different articles. Everybody's writing about, oh, here's the newest ransomware. This is what it does. Okay. That gets boring after a while. So I want to look at things like, okay, what's the psychology? But how are they exploiting that? Or let's look at the economics of ransomware. And so start pulling out those, macro topics. And then you can certainly mention different examples as you go through it. But it, taking something like that has been quite interesting, and then they persist a bit longer too. So finding some way of coming up with some interesting content, an interesting angle, is a great thing. Things that really would turn me off to, you know, a client relationship would be where they want to continually, you know, plug the product. That's not my thing. I'm trying to educate people. And if the product's a good fit, that's wonderful. That's what I want. But I'm not this, sponsored by XYZ Corp guy.
Yeah, it seems like sometimes the influencer stuff can get almost like a backdoor sponsored content kind of thing, or an endorsement. And that's something that we definitely try to avoid, and just keep if the brand shares the values that you have, then we can put out the content, and it doesn't have to say like Computer Corporation brings you Eric Vanderberg to talk about how awesome our solution is. That's what we're always trying to pull away from.
I'm going to walk into this interview looking like a NASCAR driver with logos all over me, wearing the hat.
I think the hat might suit you. I don't know about the logos on the overalls, but no, the blazer, I would stick with the blazer. So how can people find you if they want to get in touch with you?
Well, certainly on social media, LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter. Twitter is probably the biggest one, but I get a ton of messages. Mm-hmm. So I'm a little bit slow to respond.
And what's your Twitter handle? We'll link it in here, but we'll just have you read it out too.
E Vanderberg. So that's EVANDERBURG.
Sounds good. So our final question is the kind of Rorschach test question. It can mean whatever you want it to mean. What do you think that B2B leaders in your space need to do to break free?
Break free, huh? So that's probably my open-ended part, right?
That is.
I think it's to stop looking at security as something that's going to hold them back, as this big cost factor, and to start looking at it as something that will free them. You talk about breaking free. Many companies are held back right now because of fear. They may not enter that market. They may not do business in this space. They may not collect this private information because they're afraid that it may be exposed, that they may subject themselves to additional liability and all these other fears, rather than looking and saying, okay, I want to do this business. Certainly it comes at a cost, right? I need to invest in so many different ways. Security is another way to invest. And I invest in that. Now it allows me to move forward with confidence rather than shoring up my defenses and only doing what I'm comfortable with.
I don't think too many are thinking right now of security as an investment in new business capabilities. I think that's a great way to think about it. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Eric, thanks so much for being here today. And folks, you can find all of his contact information down below. So please do follow him on social media and feel free to reach out with additional questions. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time on Break Free.